पग प्यारे दंगल 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 सूरज तेरा चढ़ता ढलता गर्दिश में करते हैं तारे दंगल 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 दंगल
ग्रेट मॉर्निंग Friends, we are going to start with lecture number 3. Statistical concepts and market returns is the name of the reading. And we have already delivered, I have already delivered two lectures. You know. In those two lectures, I have discussed the introductory part. That is, learning outcome A, learning outcome B, descriptive statistics, inferential statistics. What is the difference between a population and a sample? And what are the different types of scales? In the last lecture, we discussed about parameter and sample statistics. So today, actually the statistical concepts will start from today because I will be doing some part of, you know, a learning outcome number C, which is connected with learning outcome number B, that frequency distribution, which I have not told you in the last lecture. So today is the most important lecture, highly testable for the examination, and it will build your base for the coming lectures. So let's start with the journey. And I have written a quotation for the day. No defeat is final. No defeat is final until you stop trying. So you have to try. Come on. Let's start. Lecture 3, I will be discussing with learning outcome number C. Calculate and interpret. Calculate, you have to firstly calculate and then you have to interpret and then you have to analyze. Calculate and interpret relative frequencies. What is the meaning of a relative frequency and cumulative relative frequencies? So we have to discuss two things. One is relative frequencies, second is cumulative relative frequencies. We should know why to calculate that and what is the importance of that and what analysis, what inferences we will got from that. So the first point, you know, in the last lecture, I have told you that supposing there is a test in a class and there are 15 students and there are different marks are being obtained by these students. So if I want to calculate, you know, I want to do the analysis of that. I can do analysis by different tools. Now 15 students are there in a lecture, in a class who are attempting for CFA level 1 examination and I have taken a class test for that and those 15 students have got these marks. So this is the data set. I am available with the data set of 15 students who have different marks, who have obtained different marks in a test out of 100. Now how this will be helping me in decision making? So today's lecture is focused on that. So once I know that, what is the importance of that, you know, the analysis, so that it can help you in decision making, I will be aware why we are preparing frequency distribution, why we are going for cumulative frequency distribution, why we are calculating relative frequencies, why we are calculating cumulative relative frequencies. So these items which we have to learn. The basic is why, the intention, the intuition, why it is so. So for that, I will be taking a case study and the whole lecture, I will be revolving around that case study. I will be calculating the sense of that, interpretations of that, analysis of that. And side by side, you will be aware that why these things are being calculated. For example, why you calculate frequency distribution, why you calculate, what is the use of cumulative frequency distribution, then why there is a need of relative frequencies, and then why there is a need of cumulative relative frequencies. So all these items will be there. Just writing first point, frequency distribution. It is a tabular form. You know, we will be preparing a tabular form of presentation of the data set, of the statistical data set that aids the analysis of large data sets. It means I am given with a large data set of 500 numbers. Now it will be difficult for me to, you know, summarize those 500 numbers. I prepare the frequency distribution of those 500 numbers so that I can manage the data set. I can control the data set and then I can analyze the things from that data set. So please write down A point. It is a tabular. I will be preparing a table. I will be showing you a table. It is a tabular presentation of statistical data that aids the analysis, helps the analysis of large data sets. So frequency distribution summarizes statistical data by assigning it to specified groups. It means we will be preparing some different groups. For example, in a 15 class student, different marks are there. Supposedly the lowest marks are 0 and the highest marks are 95. So I can prepare, a category for that. For example, 0 to 20 can be a category. Then how many students are there who got from 0 to 20 marks? Then from 21 to 40, how many students are there who got from 21 to 40? Then 41 to 60, then 61 to... Like this, I can prepare a category, you know. So this is frequency distribution, and I will be telling you there are three steps in that. We will be watching the images. We will be seeing from the Google Baba. So first point, I suppose you must have all written down that it is, you know, first A part is, it is a tabular presentation of statistical data. Or the data which is given to me for which I want to analyze, you know, that statistical data. It is a tabular presentation that aids the analysis of large data sets. So, following are the three steps which we generally follow in preparing frequency distribution. Firstly, we have to prepare the class intervals, the categories, the classifications, and then we have to put the marks, the tally marks, and then we have to calculate the frequency of that. So just write down B point, C point. Following are the three steps to be followed for constructing a frequency distribution. Step number one is, we will be defining the interval, we will be defining the category, we will be defining how we are going to classify. Step number two is, tally the observation. And step number three is, count the observation. So how all that we'll be doing, I will be taking one case study, and on the basis of that case study, I will be explaining you each and every point. So case study in relation to frequency distribution, or I will be discussing relative frequency distribution, I will be discussing cumulative along with this case study. So you have to write on this case study, very important for you, because then only we will be able to solve, you know, so many questions on the practical problem given to you in CFA curriculum. So suppose following are the marks obtained by 15 students in a CFA level 1 class test. Supposedly I have taken a class test of say 15 students, and these are the different marks. Now you have to analyze that from different angles, and then you have to take the decisions. So do analysis of the following data set. We have to analyze the following data set. Supposedly these are the roll numbers. On the left hand side I have written the roll numbers, and the right hand side I have written the marks obtained: 5, 12, 7, 15, 93, 0, 15, 25. These are the different marks of 15 students. So you have to write down, my dear sir, please write down. It will be a humble request to you, because you know it will be helping you in coming days. Please write down. I said write down, sit straight and write down. So these are the marks of the 15 students. Now, I have to do the analysis of these 15 marks, and on the basis of that analysis, I have to take a decision that whether students are doing bad, good, or whether the, how many, every number of students who are doing good, and whether the concepts are clear to them, whether they are doing self-study on this parlance. Or the second is, you know, I can also take a decision that whether I have to change the faculty. Because if the faculty is not able to clear the concepts, and most of the students are below average, it means the faculty, this problem is with the faculty. And in that case, I have to take a decision that whether this faculty is to be changed or not. So there are so many decisions on the basis of this analysis we can have. The first, you know, first type of analysis which I can have quickly is that I can calculate the mean of these 15, you know, how much average marks students got out of 15. The total marks are this. So I can find out average marks. That what is the average marks a student got in this test. So what I will be doing, I will be adding these, this, all these numbers. Please take out your calculators. I will be adding the marks of all these 15 students. And then I will be dividing it by 5. So I have added that. That comes to 546. Just see whether it is there or not. 546 marks, it will be divided by 15. Then it comes to 36.4 marks. It means on an average, student got 36.4 marks. On an average, 36.4 marks are there. Now this is a number, 36.4, I can now have at least an idea that this is overall on an average marks. But the point is, in 36.4, if I see the extreme numbers, the student having roll number 5 have got 93 marks, and the student having roll number of 15 got 87 marks. So these are the extreme outskirts, which are also there. So they can change the average. So if I want to check, I can say 546 minus 87 and minus 93. I don't want to include these two persons because these are exceptional cases. So after that, I want to calculate because they can affect my average. So after that, I can find out the how much is the average marks. So that comes to 546 minus 87 minus 93. That comes to 366. That comes to 366. Now, if I divide 366 by 13, then divided by 13 is equal to 28.1. So this is 28.1. You get your point? So it means on an average, students got 28.1 marks. So I have written that now in order to analyze the above data. I will be using so many tools. The first tool which I am using is mean. No doubt in a separate learning outcome, I have to tell you that what are the different tools of center tendency. Within that, I will be telling you there are 5 types of mean. But for this lecture, just have an idea. The mean is total of marks divided by total number of students, which you calculate from 3rd, 4th, 5th class from the school days. That is 36.4. But when I say 36.4, it can be an inflated number. It can be, it can be affected by the extreme figures. So I have excluded those extreme numbers. And then I have calculated 28.1, as the marks. Just see, this is a population of 15 marks, 15 students. One person who is Ramlal and second person who is Shamlal, he got 93, he got 87. So the marks of these two students can affect the average. So that's why I'm excluding this. I'm excluding this 93 and 87 marks, and then I got 30 students. Then if I divide by that, the average marks are 28.1. The average marks are 28.1 marks. So on the basis of that, I can start with that 28.1. Now, what inference I can get from 36.4 or 28.1? Whether I will be able to take decision? No, my dear sir, I cannot take a decision on the basis of 36.4 or 28.1 that whether it is a fault of students or whether it is the fault of there is a problem with the faculty. Because whether students are not doing good or faculty is not properly explaining the concepts, there can be anything. But on the basis of just mean 36.4 and 28.1, I cannot take any conclusion or any decision. So I have to take some more analysis, Just like a doctor cannot directly by just, prima facie cannot say that this is a disease you have. No doubt, he will firstly find out the symptoms. And on the basis of that symptoms, he will further analyze it. Then further test, then further reports. And then on the basis of all those deep analysis, he will be able to find out which type of disease this patient is suffering with. Similarly, with the analyst, Just with the number mean or just with the average number, he cannot analyze all the things. So he has to take the use of further deep tools. And for that, he will be using frequency distribution. So I have just given you the theory that this is a frequency distribution. It is a tabular form. It has 3 steps. First step is classification. Second is give the tally. Third is give the frequency. Now, in this, I want to tell you why there is a need of frequency distribution. Because with the help of mean, with the help of average marks, I cannot analyze anything. So there is a need of frequency distribution. I will say frequency distribution is a further step of analysis. So because of that, just see, I have written the reasons that I cannot take a decision that whether students are not working hard or the faculty is not explaining properly. I cannot take the decision on the basis of 36.4 or 28.1. So here comes the importance of categorizing data set, and then I will be doing deep analysis, and for that I have to prepare frequency distribution. Now, how to prepare a frequency distribution? It is just a table. In that, I will be firstly creating the categories, the intervals. For example, there are 90 marks highest, Then how many students, just see, how many students this should be 100. This figure should be 100, you know. I have prepared a category of 20, 20, 20. So 0 to 20, 0 to 20, 21 to 40, 41 to 60, 61 to 80, and 81 to 100. So I will be finding out that how many students have got the marks from 0 to 20, how many students have got the marks from 21 to 40, from 41 to 60, from 61 to 60, from 61 to 80, and from 81 to 90. Just see from the information which I have given to you. Out of these students, you know, who have got from 0 to 20, roll number 1, roll number 2, roll number 3, roll number 4, roll number 6, okay, roll number 7, okay, so it means 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It means 6 students have got the mark from 0 to 20. Just see the table. I have written 3 and 3, 6. Okay. So these are the 6 students I have written here. That 6 students have got the marks from 0 to 20. Similarly, I have seen for 21 to 40 that there are 3 students who have got from 21 to 40. Then again, there are 3 students from who got from 41 to 60 marks. And there is 1 student who got from 61 to 80. And there is 2 students who got from 81 to 100 marks. So it means in total there are 15 students. So I have calculated 6 plus 3 plus 3 plus 1 plus 2. That comes to 15 students. It means I can now analyze that 6 students out of 15, you know, 6 out of 15, they have got the marks from 0 to 20. It means majority of the students, they have lesser marks up to 20. Only few of the students, 1 or 2, they have got in the upper limit. So with the help of this, I can analyze so many things. Just see the interpolation and write down. Please write down the interpolation, because then only I can see the what is the importance of frequency distribution and then why we are switching to other tools. What is the limitation of this? Even for frequency distribution and why we are switching to other tools. So please write down the interpolation from the above frequency distribution. There is more number of students in a category of 0 to 20. So I can say, because there is a more number of students from 0 to 20, so there can be a problem in explaining the, you know, concepts. It means there is a problem from the faculty side. And hence, I can decide that whether to change the faculty or not. It means frequency distribution helps me in finding out or in taking the decisions as compared to mean. But it has, again, some limitations, you know. When I say limitations, it means that, you know, it can be, we can have a better tool than that. For example, I'm not aware, for example, relative, I cannot calculate how many percentage, because that is absolute which is given to me. The information in frequency distribution is absolute, that this is 6 number, 3 number, 3 number, 2 number, 1 number, but out of which, so it is better to convert into percentage. So if I convert these frequencies into percentage, I will say it is relative frequency. So here comes the importance of relative frequency. Please, I know, second point. Why we calculate relative frequency? So I will be taking the same example and I will be revolving around that. Relative frequency, it is being calculated by dividing the absolute frequency of each return or interval or category by total number of observations. It relative is very easy, you know. We are calculating the percentage. So for example, if I want to calculate the relative of this 6, so 6 is the number of which frequency having a frequency of 6 in the category of 0 to 20. Now 6 is total is 15. So I can calculate the relative frequency. I can calculate the percentage, that is 6 upon 15. So 6 upon 15 into 100. Similarly for second, 21 to 40 marks, 3 frequencies there. So 3 upon 15 into 100. 41 to 60, 3 frequencies there. 3 upon 15 into 100. So likewise, I can, you know, calculate for different frequencies. Just see the table. I have prepared for that. Or I can say it is nothing but converting that frequency into percentage forms. So it can be said relative frequency is percentage of total observations following within each interval. Or, so firstly, I am preparing a table, you know, a table of this relative frequency. Just see the relative frequency. Table showing relative frequency, the same categories there, 0 to 20, 21 to 40, 41 to 60, 61 to 80, 81 to 90 frequencies. This is there. We have already calculated that individual frequencies, then relative frequency is 6 upon 15 into 100, 3 upon 15 into 100, 3 upon 15 into 100, 1 upon 15 into 100, 2 upon 15 into 100. So I have calculated 40%, 20%, 20%, 6.6% and 13.3%. Total is 100%. Now the point is, now I will be more informed that 40% of the students have got less than 20 marks, which is a very bad result. Again, only 6.6% students have got between 61 to 80. So it is a better way, you know, better analysis when I calculate the absolute number into frequency into percentages. And when I convert the absolute number into percentages, it is a relative frequency. So hope you have understood what is the meaning of relative. Now, you know, in relative, I can analyze, you know, this is analysis. The 20% students have scored marks in between this, or this much percentage have scored between this and this. So there is a problem. I can take a decision on that. So this is the benefit of relative frequencies. So my dear friends, I have told you, first point I have told you that in a data set, I can calculate the mean. But mean will not help me taking decisions. So for that, it is better to convert into a frequency distribution. So frequency distribution will at least give me the absolute numbers, that which numbers are falling in which category. It is a better as compared to mean. But when I say relative frequency, it will tell me more better, because that absolute number has been converted into percentage. And then with the help of percentage, I can calculate more, I can analyze better. So let me move to next tool, that why there is a requirement of cumulative relative frequency or cumulative absolute frequency. There are two types of frequencies. Either I can calculate cumulative of absolute frequency, or I can calculate cumulative of relative frequency. Now the point is, why there is a need, you know, this is an intent you should be aware of, that why there is a need to prepare cumulative relative frequency table or cumulative frequency table. Why there is a need? So that point you should be clear with. It is a sum of absolute or relative frequencies. If I want to calculate cumulative absolute frequency, then it is a sum of absolute or relative frequencies up to and including the given interval, that is starting from lowest interval and progressing through the highest interval, starting from lowest to, it means I will do it for all. For example, I prepared a class interval 0 to 20, 20 to 21 to 40. Then firstly, I will be calculating from 0 to 20. Then I will be calculating from 21 to 40. Within 21 to 40, I will be adding that. Just like cumulative, which we calculate. Just see, I have prepared for you. Table showing calculation of, you know, the calculation of cumulative relative frequency. The frequency which we have just calculated, 40%, 20%, 20%, 6.6%. Now, in case I want to better, you know, better it off, it is better to go for cumulative relative frequency. Just see. In the 0 to 20, I have seen that 40% is the cumulative frequency. From 21 to 40, 60%, that is 40 plus 20. From 41 to 60, that is 80%. From 61 to 80, it means up to 80 marks, there are 86.67% students who have got up to 80 marks. Or I can say up to 20 marks, only 40% of that is okay. Up to 40 marks, 60% of students got up to 40 marks. So I can get an idea that it is a cumulative relative frequency. Earlier we have calculated just relative frequency. Now it is a case of cumulative relative frequency. So on the basis of that, I can better analyze the things, you know. So the point is, in today's lecture, I want to tell you that what is the use of a frequency distribution and what are the decisions which are not being taken with the mean, we can take with the frequency, but frequency distribution also can be more, you know, organized by converting relative frequency or by converting the cumulative relative frequency. And then I can have a better analysis and I can take a decision. Just see the Google Baba, what Google Baba is saying to us about, you know, the cumulative relative frequency, that what is cumulative relative, or before that I should be aware of that what is the meaning of frequency distribution, you know. Frequency distribution, just see here, frequency distribution, I am preparing the intervals, and on the basis of intervals, I am, this, these are the intervals. The first step in case of frequency distribution is prepare the intervals, then we go for the tally. I think there is one image which has a tally also. Just see. This is a tally. Just see. This is a tally, and then on the basis of tally, we have, you know, categorized the marks. So hope you are getting the things. As per frequency distribution, we can, you know, prepare the tally, firstly category, then tally, and then frequency. And then we can, you know, calculate relative frequency also. Cumulative frequency, or just cumulative absolute frequency, or cumulative relative frequency, because each and every has a different meaning for that. So, we have covered learning out of the number C. Be happy, be jolly, be cheerful,